Brummer on behalf of the appellant Joel Thomas. I'm from Arizona, arguing on behalf of Andrew Rosenquist's office. There are five different issues set forth in the brief. Regarding the motion to suppress, Mr. Thomas argued that he did not consent, and the district court ultimately decided that he did consent to turning his cell phone over. And what's applicable for the court to look at is the Jones and Castile cases, two different cases. So there's the five factors for the court to look at, and it's not a checklist where all five have to exist, or one has to exist, or it doesn't even have to be those five factors. As the government says in their brief.
I understand that. Factual predicate. So the police collect all the phones, right?
There were two phones, yes.
Okay. It wasn't just his phone.
No, there was also.
Turn off your phones.
The manager, too, yes.
And does he claim he didn't consent to that?
He is claiming he didn't consent to it. And there was conflicting testimony from the officers of whether it was a demand that he turn over the telephone, turn over the cell phone, or was it a request and he acquiesced to it. So the three different officers say kind of three different things. There's the one who is the uniformed officer from the Peoria Police Department. He's the first to arrive in uniform, the one with everybody has a gun on their hip. And
none of
them draw.
So the gun on the hip doesn't mean anything.
And there's the two men. There's Thomas, and then there's the manager, Mr. Carlin. So Officer 11 tells both of the men, make whatever calls you need to make. I know your victims. I want you to be comfortable, whatever. So the men both make calls, and Mr. Thomas appears to be more texting rather than being on the phone. So Officer 11 says, this is an odd, because I said they could do this. But then he communicates this to the detective, and he says, the one guy seems to be texting a lot. But of course, if someone's holding a phone, you don't know if it's texting, you don't know if it's checking a website, you don't know what it is.
Texting, you can see thumbs moving.
You will see thumbs moving, but if you have your iPhone and you're searching a website, your thumbs are going to move too.
I see. So I'm sorry, I just don't do texting. So there's a record in here that says that he was texting. You're saying that somehow there's some record in here as to whether the officer was telling the truth. Am I missing something?
Sure. The point is that the officer doesn't really know what he's doing.
What evidence is there that the officer doesn't really know what he's doing?
Sure.
Evidence?
Yeah. The officer's testimony is that he has no idea if he's deleting information. He really doesn't have any idea if he's texting. He doesn't really know what he's doing. He just knows he's sort of the language that was used was that he was manipulating the phone with his thumbs. So kind of typing. But he's not looking at the screen, so he doesn't know if it's text or what's going on. But the detectives arrive, and then suddenly it seems like Officer 11 has some concerns. And he talks to Detective Balsam, and Balsam says, he doesn't say, go ask him if he'll turn his phone over. He tells him to take it and that he needed to take it. Officer 11's testimony is that Thomas turned it off and appeared to be good with it. But that's a little confusing because if an officer is going to say, I need your phone, 99.99% of people, I think, are just like, oh, here you go. They're not going to take it as, oh, I have a chance to say, I'm not going to turn it over when an officer says, turn it over, I need your phone.
That's the words the officer used, turn it over, I need your phone. The officer that talked to him.
He said that. His instruction from Detective Balsam was to take the phone, and he needed to take it.
Yeah, that doesn't help us at all. It's the words that the police officer used to defend that. Specifically, what were those words?
I'm I don't know exactly, but in his report, he said Thomas turned off the phone or asked to turn off the phone and seemed good with turning over the phone.
So
what do we do with that?
If you want to show some sort of coercion or that the phone is seized, turned off, you have to come up with that.
Sure. Well, the evidence is from the officers who were saying they said they were taking the phone. They didn't say, if you look at the Johnson and the Jones and the Castile case.
But let's look at this case. What did they actually say?
They said, so that was Officer Levin. He says that he was following the instructions from Balson, that he was instructed to take the phone, and he needed to take the phone.
You've told us already. What does he say about what he communicated to the defendant?
Yeah.
In the testimony, I'm not entirely clear that he ever communicates what he says, except to...
So that doesn't help you?
No.
What have you got that helps you?
Sure. What I have that helps me is, so Detective Balson, then, he talks about what he communicates to Officer Levin. And he tells Officer Levin, he doesn't say, go see if...
Officer Levin is not trying to suppress anything. He's keeping your client.
Right.
What evidence is there as to what was said to your client?
So, the evidence is from what Balson tells Levin, tells him you have to go take the phone.
We've gone over this three times. We told you that doesn't count.
Okay.
Okay, so you can keep saying the same thing all over again, but just to drive some of the point, you've got nothing. If that's the case, you might as well just say it and move on to your next point. Is there anything that is on the record that suggests any kind of coercion in the statement that was communicated to your client? Does anybody say, did your client say, does Officer Levin say, I told him he must turn over the phone, or some cognate of that, some equivalent?
Thomas doesn't testify, so no. And Levin instructs what he was instructed by Balson.
He could have testified, right?
He could have testified.
He wouldn't have waived the Fifth Amendment, would he?
He would not have.
They're testifying on a suppression. This was a suppression hearing, right?
Yes, it was.
So he could have testified without. I mean, he might have had to lie, which I assume.
Yeah.
I guess I'm seeing why he might not want to testify. But the fact is, he doesn't testify.
He does not testify. There was
nothing any of the officers said that supports. They testify that supports the view that they said anything coercive to him. So, what have you got?
Sure. I respectfully disagree. And I know the court keeps saying that I'm saying the same thing, but Balson did instruct Levin that he had to take the phone. It wasn't something where he said, you just have to turn the phone. You just ask him if he wants to turn the phone over. And there was another way they could have done this. Because Balson says he's...
So what do you think? Let's say he did compel him to turn off the phone. What would he have needed at that point? Some cause for the suspicion? What as to the circumstance? What is...
To seize the phone?
Yeah.
He would have needed...
Let's say he had this evidence prison that he had actually gone ahead and grabbed the phone. He said, you must take the phone, or I'm ordering you to turn it over. Let's say that had happened.
Sure. He would need, if he hadn't done that, if I'm understanding the question right, like if he didn't have the phone at all, he would need probable cause and a warrant to be able to see the phone.
So they got a warrant to get get what was on the phone, the contents of the phone.
Right.
We're talking about the taking the physical object. Mm-hmm.
They would need probable cause and a warrant.
Why would they need that?
Because of the Riley case. The Riley case.
They're not looking inside the phone at that point.
Mm-hmm.
They're just taking it so that the defendant or the suspect, Mr. Thomas, can keep manipulating it and maybe erasing information or locking it or whatever. Mm-hmm. The various things one can do with an iPhone.
Sure. So Riley, Riley talks about needing the warrant to search it. And it should be the same.
There's no doubt about it. Very likely he needs a warrant to actually search it, to actually get it.
Okay.
But we're not at that point.
Right.
Because it was a warrant. They did not actually search the phone until getting a warrant, right? What does he need to take the phone away? Let's say it was coerced or ordered or compelled. What does he need to take the phone away, the physical object, so that the suspect no longer... Why isn't father suspicion enough? And why isn't exigent circumstance enough? Yeah, he sees him there. He's punching keys.
Sure.
He has some concern that this might be somebody who's involved in the robbery, and he wants to make sure that nothing, there's no manipulation going on that will make any warrant then useless because he erased information.
The exigent circumstances would be what they need, but they didn't have it because the exigent circumstances that the district court says is that the officers were afraid that maybe the information was going to be deleted. But the Riley case says you don't get to use that as an excuse. You don't get to say, well, the information could get deleted, so we need to take the phone.
Riley dealt with actual search of the phone itself.
It dealt with an actual search.
You said that going into the contents of the database, right?
It does, but what Riley says, which is important, is it's discussing the extra privacy interests that are related to a cell phone, which can be related to a seizure as well. It doesn't talk about it. I mean, it talks about, describes what can be on the cell phone, medical records, that sort of thing, and it seems like it takes it further than, like, a search of a house. Specifically, they say it's even more than a search of your pockets because there's a ton more that you have on that cell phone.
Sure.
So
could we go back just for a second to the consent part? Under Reed case, I'm not a big factor person, but we do have factors in Reed. The district court went over them. It was not in custody. They were not in drawn guns. They did not give him Miranda, and they did not tell him anything that one of the factors that would indicate that the district judge was wrong on the consent issue. Why wouldn't that be enough? Was there any abuse of his discretion in making that finding that he wasn't in custody and it was a proper consent?
Yes, the
what did Judge Campbell do that was wrong?
Sure. The officers had Mr. Thomas in the crime scene truck, and they say that he's free to leave, but when he talks about going to pick up his sister, they say, oh no, we'll have someone else go pick up your sister, which indicates he's not free to leave. They won't
return. Maybe that's being helpful.
Being helpful? I don't know, because right away they say that they're suspicious because...
There is a difference between saying you can't leave and saying, you know, your reason for leaving, whether they just make it unnecessary for you to leave, as a matter of convenience to us, maybe, you know, you're a witness, you're here, you know, we don't want you leaving because we may need to ask you questions. So we'll pick up your sister then. Why does that show compulsion? How does that show compulsion?
Because they're saying, we'll go get your sister, not that we're going to be helpful. So it's keeping him in the same place. It's making him not free to leave. And their officers...
Well, I mean, you know, this is sort of far-fetched, but let's say you have a dinner party and you find out that one of your guests has been drinking a little much.
Okay.
And you say, listen, you can sleep here tonight.
Sure.
And I'm stopping him from leaving. I just sort of make it convenient for him to stay. Isn't it, you know...
I'm also not a police officer with a gun on my hip with the person in a crime scene truck. That's just different.
I'm drunk.
No, I mean, that is fair. I mean, I think that's a fair distinction, but there's also a distinction between saying, look, we'll make it convenient for you to stick around for our convenience.
Right.
So it would be helpful to you, not because we're such nice people necessarily, all that, but we have a reason, you know, we're doing an investigation, we don't want our witnesses unavailable if we have, you know, we discover a clue and we want to ask questions.
Sure.
You know, so we can conduct our investigation, so it's convenient for us to have the witnesses here. So it will make it easier for you not to leave from your system.
Yeah, and
it's hard to make coercion into that.
I understand the court's point, but looking at the totality of the amount of time that they kept in there, the 2 hours versus the 15 minutes that they say it usually takes for interviewing someone, having him in the crime scene truck, they say that they basically had to open the door to get him out. He wasn't in a situation where he would have been free to leave.
Okay.
I'm over.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much.
We'll hear from the government.
Good morning. Rachel Hernandez on behalf of the United States. May it please the court, this is a case of overwhelming evidence. The defendant, a bank teller, together with his friends, robbed 3 banks, 2 of them at gunpoint. The defendant helped plan the robberies, and he helped procure the weapons. Furthermore, as the jury heard, the defendant admitted as much in his pretrial interviews. In the third heist, which yielded over $200,000, the defendant can be seen on video trailing behind the gunman, his friend, as the bank manager was ordered to the vault at gunpoint. Moving directly to the issue that was just discussed, the motion to suppress was properly denied. The court found, and the court's the district court's ruling is reviewed for clear error, the court found that the defendant consented to turning over his phone. When the police arrived on scene, and it was shortly after the robbery occurred, both victims were said, you can keep your phones, you can make a phone call to let people know you're okay, or if you need to inform your management, but other than that, stay off your phone until we have time to conduct the interviews and see what's what here. The bank manager did that, and he wasn't seen on his phone after that. However, the defendant was seen manipulating his phone.
I see your time. I think we understand this issue.
Okay.
I didn't, because it's just the opposite of what I was interested in the other attorney. And so could you just finish that part?
Sure.
Because I'm not clear on whether or not he committed clear error in finding consent.
And so he was seen using his phone. The FBI came on scene and noticed that he was acting differently than the manager, and they said, as we're controlling the scene here, as we're figuring out this investigation, please get those 2 phones, and the officer went to collect them. The defendant said, can I turn it off? And he said, sure. It was a consensual discussion. At that point, both phones were taken. At the suppression hearing, the officers testified. I don't think it's entirely clear. I don't think it was clear in their reports and therefore not entirely clear at the suppression hearing the exact words used. But the officer said, I went to collect their phones. He took both phones. And the fact that the defendant was able to exercise control over the phone, the officer didn't say, unlock it and give it to me, or no, hand it over right now. He said, sure, can I turn it off? And the officer said, sure. And they took a phone that was turned off and held it until they completed an interview. And the officers testified that when they began to interview the defendant, he was still considered a victim teller. They had no reason to think otherwise. It was during the interview when he gave inconsistent answers, when he said things that were not consistent with the things a victim teller would say, that they became suspicious. And to the point that was raised by counsel, and I'll make this my final point on this issue, the fact that it was consensual, he did leave. He left the interview with his phone behind. He was not in custody. He was asked if he would consent to a search of his phone. He said no. It was purely a consensual encounter. Well, I have a couple of points to that. The first is that the district court made a record as to why the sentence on the counts he had discretion was reasonable.
I don't have any procedure. I mean, I know this judge struggled with the sentence. And I did everything to dot the I's and cross the T's. I'm not really talking about the bottom line of the sentence. 50 years, basically, 4.5 years.
Yes. I would like to point out, and I don't know if it was entirely clear in the brief, and for that I apologize, the lowest statutory sentence that he could have gotten.
25.
No, actually, let me lay this out. On counts 2 and 7, there was a mandatory minimum 10-year under 2113E. There was a finding by the jury that in two robberies, somebody was forced to accompany the person to another location. So that's a mandatory 10. A mandatory 7 on count 3, and a consecutive mandatory 25. And the 7 was consecutive and the 25. So the minimum, the statutory minimum, is 42. So in the context of that, I would say the 49.5 is reasonable, given the facts in this case that the district court found.
I mean, because it's 42 is minimum, he is entitled to, it was reasonable. I mean, if you come up with an unreasonable sentence by piling on the minimums, that means that you can add more. And then, is it true that, I haven't done the calculations that all of those things stack up and they have to be consecutive?
The 7 and the 25, the two 924Cs need to be consecutive, and the mandatory minimum for 2 and 7 were 10. So, a lawyer doing math, but I did come up to 42 years, 504 months.
They all have to be consecutive. You just said something.
Yes, because the 10 is set out, the 7 has to be consecutive to that, and the 25 has to be consecutive to that.
And with the counts that were not mandatory minimums, he was going on the scale, lowest level on those, right?
He gave the lowest guideline range on that, the bottom of the guideline range. Not the statutory bottom, but the bottom of the guideline range, correct.
So if he had to give the mandatories, and he gave the minimum, the lowest of the guideline, the only way he could have given less time and still be a legal sentence would be to go below the guideline range on the ones that have no mandatory minimum.
He could have gone lower. So the ones, the counts that were the bank robberies, not the 924Cs, the conspiracy, the bank robberies, the armed robbery, he gave 210 months. He could have lowered those as low as he could go on those is 10 years because two of those counts, well, he could have gone lower on some of the other counts, but the lowest that two of those counts could have been is 10. And so 120 months, and he gave 210 months. He acknowledged that he had discretion on those counts, but he said that the facts and circumstances of pointing weapons at people and going into banks justified, even given his lack of criminal history and the fact that he was a smart guy who was educated, but still in his consideration of the 3553 factors, he felt that a sentence of 210 months was reasonable.
He didn't feel comfortable in reducing that.
He said, exactly. He said, I understand I can balance it out, but I don't think that's appropriate here. He did have a complaint with the mandatory minimums under 924C, but as this court has held previously, that's not necessarily a consideration. That's the statutory minimum.
That's what he said. He said he didn't care for the mandatory minimums, but that's what he's required to give because that's what the statute the Congress has passed. So there's lots of things we don't like that Congress does or doesn't do. But as I read that, I came to this same conclusion. It's a lot of years tacked on, but he did give him the low end of the place where he had the opportunity to do so. And then he made a finding that it was the entirement for that reason was reasonable.
Yes, that he felt that given everything he had to, the 924C sentences.
Why was it reasonable for him not to depart? I mean, it's one thing to say this is the sentencing range and there's nothing else going on. But when he's stacking that sentence on top of these mandatory minimums, he felt constrained not to do it. It sounds to me like he said, you know, I can't do it. It's not clear. But why shouldn't the judge look at the total sentence for the conduct and say, reduce the counts that he can reduce when the defendant is already serving severe sentence?
Well, guideline 5G1.2A says that in cases like a 924C statutory construction where there are mandatory minimums and they must be imposed consecutively, the court should impose those sentences independently. And that's what the court did here. And I do think it's clear. He said,
but when doing a substantive, a reasonless review, they step back and look at the entire sentence for the entire conduct. Isn't that the test? You look at everything the defendant did, and you look at the bottom line sentence and ask, is that totally reasonable?
Well,
and if it's not, if it's substantively unreasonable, then isn't the district judge required to go down from there?
I think it seems that the district court was trying to square this requirement under the guidelines. And as I said, imposing a sentence that was reasonable where he had discretion, and it seems that that was what his mandate is in the areas where he has discretion, he has given a reasonable sentence.
But he couldn't simply say, I don't like the effect of the mandatory minimums in this case, so I'm going to reduce the mandatory minimums.
Right. There is precedent from this court and sister circuits that say specifically that, and particularly in a bank robbery case where a judge had in, I believe, the Seventh Circuit, a judge had reduced a bank robbery sentence because of the 924C, and it was held that that kind of guts Congress's intent on the 924Cs. And I think that's what the sentencing guideline, the 5G1.2, is getting at as well. The sentence needs to be determined independent of whatever is going to be stacked on top.
So the issue for him was whether or not to reduce the ones that he had discretion over, and he felt that those sentences were appropriate.
He felt those were appropriate, and he noted that he understood he had discretion on those counts, but he didn't feel it was appropriate to balance it out, as we discussed previously.
You said the Seventh Circuit law. Is there a Ninth Circuit law?
There is Ninth Circuit law. It is a pre-Booker case, but it was United States versus Working, and I cited it in a 28-J letter. If the court has no further questions, I'd ask that you affirm the convictions and the sentence. Thank you.
Do you have time? Do you want us to spend a minute to talk about sentencing?
The district court said some odd things regarding the sentencing. He said he was not comfortable reducing the non-mandatory minimum sentences, but he said, I wouldn't impose these sentences if I had the discretion, and which Thomas argues the court is acknowledging it's an unreasonable sentence. It is a 50-year sentence.
Wait a minute. The judge says that I can't reduce a mandatory minimum. That's an unreasonable sentence just because he makes that statement.
No.
I've made that statement as a district judge, and I didn't feel I was.
No, not that part, Your Honor, and I'm sorry. It's where he says, I won't impose if I had discretion. But on some of the counts, he did have discretion.
Why he was not taking things into discretion.
Right, exactly. But then he makes a blanket statement that I don't have discretion when he did have discretion on several
of the counts. As I read, he was talking about the mandatory minimums. He wasn't talking about the others. Judge Camp, I don't think you can read that into Judge Campbell's statement. That's a bit of a stretch. Judge Campbell is smart enough to know that he doesn't have discretion when there's mandatory minimums. And within what he says, he has discretion, but he isn't going to use it because it's not reasonable. He knows exactly what he's saying. I didn't think that was unclear.
We thought it was unclear.
Yeah, well, I understand you thought it was unclear. Now, did you make an objection at that time?
Not true.
That he is unclear and he's
wrong? Not trial counsel.
No,
so,
trial counsel didn't even raise it.
Yeah,
trial counsel did. We thought it was clear.
And, well.
Do you agree with opposing counsel's calculation of how far down the judge could have gone? If I heard from the counsel is that if you stack up the mandatory minimums the way that
they would have been the 42 years anyways. I wasn't clear on that from the briefs or from the sentencing memorandum. I thought it was just the 25 and the 7 were the mandatory minimums, and then there was discretion on the other ones, not that it had to be 10.
Why don't you give us a 28-J letter on that? I mean, the government has been very clear today, which I have not seen before, as to what the numbers are. And if you're not clear, and this is surprising you, maybe you can go back and do the calculations. And if you disagree with the government, why don't you say give us a 28-J letter in the next 48 hours?
Okay.
Telling us your counter calculations.
All right. Because the 28.
There is one I want a response from the government.
Yeah. The 28J letters from the government did not discuss that being the 10 years. It was that.
Are you arguing with me?
No.
Are you going to give me a calculation now?
No, Your Honor. I'm just showing that.
What's the point? What are you trying to show?
I'm just making, I just wanted to make a record that the 28J letters that are already in were not on that issue.
Why? I just told you you have a chance to present your hand.
Got it.
What more would you like, what else would you like to achieve by telling me that?
On that, nothing.
You just decided to talk. Give us a letter by Tuesday. You can turn that into government. This is you to have what you want to hear from the government. I think it's important to have numbers.
Okay.
If there's disagreement as to those numbers, I think most counts have been, very conscientious as well. So I don't mean any criticism of anybody. It's a difficult case, and it's, I just want to make sure we have the numbers right.
Understood.
Okay. Thank you, case. Just I will stand submitted. We have one more case in the calendar. Nehara versus. Yes, we're in the next case. Nehara versus State of California Department of Corrections.